Well, let's put our hands together. Let's set the atmosphere for whatever it is you're expecting from God. Because I know when you come expecting something great, He will do just what you need Him to do. Amen. Oh, Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name. Your name is strength, your name is power. A strong tower makes me safe. Oh, there's nobody like you, Lord. Nobody like you, Lord. Oh, there's nobody like you, Lord. Nobody like you, Lord. Sing, oh Lord. Oh Lord, our Lord, our Lord. Sing, how excellent, how excellent is your name, is your name. Your name is strength,
your name is strength.
Your name is power,
your name is power.
A strong tower,
a strong tower.
It makes me say, come on, just say, oh, oh, nobody like you, Lord.
Nobody like you, Lord.
Sing, oh, oh, there's nobody like you, Lord.
Nobody
like you, Lord. Go back to the top one more time. Sing, oh, 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 Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name. Your name is strength.
Your name is strength.
Your name is power. Yes, God. And a strong tower. Makes us safe. Say, oh,
oh,
oh, oh, there's nobody like you, Lord.
Nobody like you, Lord.
Sing, oh, 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 there's nobody.
Oh,
Come on.
Thank you. Come on, saints, let's give God a hand clap of praise. The song says, there's nobody like you, Lord. There's none like him, and there's none besides him. Good morning, First Baptist Church, Denby. Who is glad to be in the house of the Lord one more time? I didn't hear. Who is glad to be in the house of the Lord one more time? Amen. We're standing all over the building for the call to worship. The word declares, praise ye the Lord. Praise him in his sanctuary. Praise him in the firmament of his power. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Let everything that have breath praise ye the Lord. Now join in with our choir as they send us further in worship.
He's just all right. He's
Song says I tried him, and I found out he's all right with me. I know when I tried him, he picked me up. Then he turned my life around, and he placed my feet on solid ground. Is anybody in the house today tried him and found out that he's all right with you? He's all right with me. Let's give God a hand clap of praise, because he's all right. Glory to God in the highest. We're now going to have our scripture reading by Deaconess Maxine Wright, followed by prayer by Deacon Linwood Wright. Let's give God a hand clap of praise for them as they come. Amen.
Good morning, church family. Good morning, church family. To God be the glory. It is wonderful to see each and every one of you today in the sanctuary. Praise the Lord to those that are listening to us at this time. If you can prepare your hearts for God's word, found in Jeremiah 8th chapter, 19th through the 22nd verse. That's Jeremiah 8th chapter, 19th to the 22nd verse. And it reads, "Behold the voice of the cry of the daughter of my people, because of them that dwell in a far country. Is not the Lord in Zion? Is not her king in her? Why have they provoked me to anger with their graven images and with strange vanities? The harvest is past, the summer is ended, and we are not saved. For the hurt of the daughter of my people, am I hurt? Am I black? Astonishment have taken hold on me. Is there no balm in Gilead? Is there no physician there? Why then is not the health of the daughter of my people recovered?" God's word is already blessed. Amen.
Amen. How many of you are grateful?
Hallelujah.
Amen. We serve a grateful God. Amen. Amen. What a powerful message. The choir is singing this morning. Amen. Amen. Can you hear me? May we bow our heads for a word of prayer. Testing. You can hear me? Okay. My side partner saying it's not. Amen. Bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you for just being a great God and a great God to serve. Lord, as I begin to pray, oh Lord, I ask that you allow me to concentrate
and focus just on you, oh God. Lord, I'm not here for no entertainment, but to just lift up the name of Jesus. Lord, I ask everyone that's here as well, oh God, that they block out anything, Lord, that's not focused on you this morning. Those that are at home and those, oh Lord, who are in the sanctuary. Lord, we just want to give 100% of our lives, our being, Lord, just to you. So, Lord, we just thank you, oh God, for just allowing us to see another day. Lord, we thank you, oh God, for this Thanksgiving season, oh God. Lord, we just thankful, oh God, for you, that you sacrificed your son, oh God, just for us. Lord, we ask that you forgive us, oh God, of anything, Lord, that we may have thought, said, or done that's not pleasing in your sight, oh God. Lord, we ask you right now, Lord, to anoint every person that's here. Lord, we already know, Lord, that you're going to bless them with many blessings, favors, oh God, healing, miracles, oh God, that are going to come today, oh God. So, Lord, be with everyone in this service as we go forward in this service, oh God. We ask, Lord, now that you create in us a clean heart and renew a right spirit within us, oh God. That you touch, Lord, those that are sick and shut in, oh God. Those who have lost loved ones, oh God. Those, Lord, whose body is racked in pain, oh God. Those that may be going through something that may not know what it is, oh God. Your word said that asking it shall be given, oh God. Seeking it shall be found, Lord, and the knock and the door shall be open. So we know already that you've healed our body, oh God. That you've made a way, Lord, out of no way, oh God. That you've made a way, Lord, that we couldn't see it, Lord, but you saw it, oh God. Lord, we just thank you now, Lord, for those, Lord, who are going through this season, Lord, where they're thinking about the loss of their loved ones, oh God. Lord, in Proverbs it said, Lord, lean not to our own understanding, but in our ways, oh Lord, acknowledge you and you shall direct our paths, oh God. Lord, we don't know why you took some folks home, oh God. We don't know why you kept some here, oh God. But we know, oh God, that we can trust and lean on you, the author and finisher of our faith, oh God. So bless everyone, Lord, that today, tomorrow, this Thanksgiving season, we know it that we will eat in fellowship, but in all that we do, God, that we continue, Lord, to keep up the name of Jesus, to focus on you, oh God, knowing that there's power, oh God, in the name of Jesus, oh God. There's healing, oh God, in the name of Jesus, oh God. There's deliverance, oh God, in the name of Jesus, Lord. There's peace, oh God, in the name of Jesus, oh God. So be with us, oh God, as we go forward in this service. Touch us, lift us up, oh God. The speaker of the hour, oh God, anoint him afresh, oh God. Touch him, Lord, like never before, oh God. Give him preaching power, oh God. Give him clarity, oh God. That he may say something, oh Lord. To have someone coming, asking, what must I do to be saved, oh God. And then, Lord, those that are going through surgery, whatever they may be going through this week, oh God, let them know that they're not alone, oh God. We ask that your anointing, oh Lord, touch the doctor, the nurse, oh God. Bless our people, oh God. Those that are coming home from college over the holiday season, oh God, be with them as they travel. We just thank you, God, for First Baptist Church Denby, the church with the heart and the heart of Denby, oh God. Lord, as we go forward in this service, oh God, let us get excited for what you're about to do. We're not going to be spectators. We're not going to try to be entertained, oh God, but we're going to lift up the name of Jesus like never before. We just thank you, God. We love you, Lord. It's in your son Jesus' name I do pray and say, amen.
man. Is anybody in the house today grateful? Yeah, are you grateful that he woke you up this morning? Are you grateful that he started you on your way? Are you grateful that he put food on your table? Are you grateful that he put clothes on your back? The song says we can go on and on and on thinking about the goodness of Jesus. Because when we think of the goodness of Jesus and all that he's done for you and all that he's done for me, our souls cry out in gratitude. I thank God for saving me. Are there any grateful folk in the house this morning? If you're grateful, go ahead and open up your mouth and give God glory. Stand to your feet and give him praise, because he is worthy of every benefit. I'm grateful today, God, because you saved my soul. I'm grateful today, God, because you saved my family. I'm grateful today, God, because you gave me a job. I'm grateful today, God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I'm grateful today, God. You are worthy all by yourself. I'm grateful. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Grateful today, God. To God in the highest. So grateful to God today. Certainly want to thank Deaconess Maxine Wright for the reading of the Word of God in our hearing. And we certainly want to thank Deacon Linwood Wright for that wonderful prayer. Amen. We're now going to be blessed with a treat by our praise in motion. Let's give God a hand clap of praise as they minister us in dance.
Looked as if it was over.
Lord, you made
Oh, yes, he is a way maker. Amen. We give God glory for our praise and motion and him blessing us in this way, reminding us that he made a way. Amen. Now have our announcements by Deacon Linwood Wright.
Praise the Lord, church. Amen. Let me ask you this question while I'm trying to get my notes together. How many of you know God made a way? Some of you don't act like it. Listen, church. Y'all know my condition, right? That I had a blood clot, right? And we do family prayer. We do family prayer, and we pray every week. My four daughters, two son-in-laws, my grandson, my wife, and I. And this song just brings back where it said we made a way. You know, I was going over with my family, my condition. And one of my daughters had texted the family and they said, hey, daddy is talking to the church about his condition. So I had the blood clot in my leg and then it went to my lungs, right? And my son-in-law, matter of fact, he's in here now. He says to the family, you know, dad, my sister had a blood clot in her leg and God took her home. So how you know, but God made a way for me to be here. I don't know about you and what God has done for you or what he haven't done for you. If he haven't done anything for you, just keep on living. But he'll make a way for you out of no way. I told you earlier, we got to stop coming here for to be entertained, but to come here to lift up the name of Jesus. It's not about coming here and having a seat, but it's a thing about thanking God for what he's done in our life. And I'm going to tell you, if you don't think he did anything for you, guess who woke you up this morning? The Lord. That should be enough right there for you to be able to stand up and thank the Lord. I just don't get it how we don't want to thank God for how good he's been to us. God is just so good. Everybody in here, he woke us up. So that's a reason to thank God. He's not only has he healed me, he's healed you. He's paid our bills. He's got our kids through college, through high school. He allowed us to drive a car this morning. We got clothes on our back, shoes on our feet. We in our right mind, we can say our name, we can speak, we can breathe. Come on, church. God just made a way. He's a way maker. He's a miracle worker. I don't know about you, but I know about me, and I just thank God for his many blessings. Amen. 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 God is just good, church. He's good. He's good. He's good, church. He's good. He's good. Amen. I didn't get up here planning on doing that, but he's good. He's really good. That song is deep. I don't know how, but he did it. I have seven sisters, four brothers, mom and dad, and we had a four-room house, outhouse. I don't know how he did it, but he did it. Amen, amen, amen.
We're going to pause for a cause. The anointing is in this place. We're going to do a few administrative announcements, and then we're going to get back into this service. Amen. Good morning, and here are your morning announcements. Happy birthday and happy anniversary to all celebrating the great month of November, tribe of Reuben. You know, I have a father born in November. My wife and sister born on the same day. Happy birthday, honey, 19th. And then I want to do a special shout out to George and Valerie McKeever. They're celebrating their 40th anniversary today. Happy anniversary to you. Church, there's no Bible study on Monday for the youth or Wednesday at 12 noon or 7 p.m. for the adults. Our prayer conference call number is 951-981-7368. Again, the prayer conference call number is 951-981-7368. And I understand some of you that are calling in are having a challenge by T-Mobile. When you call T-Mobile, they're charging you a fee. What I ask you to do is please call Minister Grace at 757-676-2886. And he'll give you instructions where you can call in for free. Continue to call in for free, amen. We're not gonna let someone charge money just because, but call Minister Grace at 757-676-2886 and he'll give you instructions. We have new members class every morning at 9 a.m. Every Sunday morning in the library at 9 a.m. to those new members. I want to thank all who participated in our First Baptist Church, Denby Love and Action Distribution on yesterday. Thank you, thank you, thank you to Ms. Spells and team. It was successful. We want to also thank Mu Beta Phi as a military organization who come out to also support us. Want to thank them. For those who registered and was not able to come out yesterday, you can come by the church tomorrow between 10 and 11 a.m. For those who registered who did not come out, and for those of you who wanted to come but did not come, you can come as well. Amen? Amen. Amen. I just think it's a blessing how we are reaching out to serve the community as well as our family. So tomorrow the time is 10 to 11 a.m. For those who registered who did not come out for some reason and those who wanted to register but didn't, please come out tomorrow. Church, there is no harvest feast service or meal on Tuesday. There is no Thanksgiving service on Thursday. There is no seven churches as well. Amen. I want to just say a lot of these things are based on COVID. The church is also closed Wednesday through Saturday, and there's no Thanksgiving service on Thursday. So please don't come to the church knocking on the door Wednesday through Saturday. Amen? The doors will be closed. I just want to put emphasis on that. Okay, it's good to see so many of you in here. We ask that you continue to keep on your mask. We've done our temperature checks. And when the church service is over, we ask that you exit to your right, which is my left, or to your left. Amen. I want to also thank Deacon Ware and Brother Godfrey. They sent me a picture, Brother Godfrey did, showing where they gave out some things. So bear with me as I read this. I want to thank Deacon Godfrey. Deacon Ware and Brother Godfrey was asking several veterans and family members to donate $100. So in December of 2020, they purchased 23 new coats. Well, this year, along with some members from the prayer ministry and families, they purchased 50 coats, 60 each underwears, 48 undershirts, and 96 pairs of socks. So, Jim, I just want to thank you
as well for reaching out to the community. Not finding Robbie just to focus on you, but focus on others. Okay, the United 8 Collective is honored to bring their second United Night of Prayer and Praise for all youth in the community on December the 4th. Initially, it was December the 11th. It's going to be at First Baptist Church Denby. The doors will open at 5 p.m., and service will start at 5:30 p.m. United 8 Collective in honor. Now, church, I came to the last one. Those young people are on fire, lifting up the name of Jesus in their way. If you don't come, I ask that you pray for them, amen, and keep them encouraged. So get ready for a night of worship, prayer, and praise. Okay, I'm just about done with the announcements. Prison ministry, Angel Tree is back. Angels will be ready for selection. And this year, only one gift per child for $25. And the note from the Angel Tree Committee is, thank you for participating in the First Baptist Church Denby Angel Tree program. Please attach your angel to the wrapped gift or gift bag and return to the church office no later than Sunday, 5 December. If you have any questions, please contact Thelma Dobbs at 757-877-0896 from 8 to 4:30. And church, we've been doing this. We didn't do it last year, and I ask that you please support the Angel Tree Prison Ministry. And church, if you take an Angel Tree, make sure you bring a gift back. Amen? Amen. We ask that you continue to pray for our known sick and shut in. Renee Irvin, her surgery went well. Continue to pray for Sendell Daniels. Brother Deacon Archie, pray for him. Harry Golden. Trustee Milton Carey had a procedure. Keep him in prayer. Kim Grant, who went to the hospital, talked to her yesterday. Keep her lifted in prayer. Deacon Gay, who have a procedure on Thursday, keep him lifted in prayer. For those of you who have the bulletin, well, I ask that you keep all our known sick and shut in lifted in prayer. Amen. Our condolences go to Deacon and Trainer Thomas Myers. His wife's sister passed on Friday. Please keep the Jones family in prayer. Funeral arrangements is incomplete. Also keep Linda Gray, her first cousin accident, keep them lifted in prayer. And we also ask that you continue to pray for our known sick and shut in, as well as our pastoral search committee as they take on their yeoman's task. May we bow our heads as I pray over the tithes and offering. Lord, I just want to thank you for making a way out of no way, for being at peace in the midst of the storm, for allowing us, Lord, to give back a portion of what you have given us. Lord, continue to bless those who gave. Lord, bless those who wanted to give but have not. Not only here at First Baptist Church, but those that are either by Facebook and YouTube. Continue to strengthen them, guide, and protect them. It's in your Son, Jesus' name, I do pray and say, amen. And Mr. Perkins, I got one more thing. Okay, I just want to leave you with this Thanksgiving poem, amen. It's so befitting. Again, it's Thanksgiving. If you can, this Thanksgiving, if you know someone who may not have a meal or need a meal, reach out and try to invite them to your family. Amen. If you can invite them, if you can give them something, please do so. Amen. So the title of this poem is titled Thanksgiving Day. Thanksgiving Day is special, but would have no meaning at all if we didn't acknowledge how grateful we are when our prayers are answered when we call. We are thankful for his faithfulness, his love and mercy too, keeping us safe, letting us know there's nothing he can't do. Can you count the many blessings you've already received today, or the many times he made a way? Or is it because he blessed us beyond measures, even when we don't give our times, talents, and treasures? All we need to do is say, forgive us. We praise you for all you do. We'll bless your holy name and say, thank you. So happy Thanksgiving Day to all of you. And the poem is written by no other than Mother Hazel Flood. God bless you. Testing. Someone left their watch and is out in the vestibule. Okay. Amen.
Amen. We certainly thank God for Deacon Linwood Wright and the announcements, and we ask that you would govern yourselves accordingly. But I'm just excited to hear that testimony. I don't know about you, but it encouraged me, because I'm not going to let the rocks cry out for me. I'm going to give him glory. And I'm going to give him praise because he's done too much for me. So God bless you, sir. Appreciate that testimony. Amen. Well, saints, it's preaching time. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, it's preaching time. And we do have a preacher in the house, Reverend Dr. Earl C. Johnson. We thank God for him. We thank God for his leadership, and we are in the spirit of expectation to hear another powerful word from our interim pastor. The next voice we will hear after this dynamic, anointed choir. Oh, God is using y'all to edify the body of Christ, and we thank God for you. After we hear this choir, the next voice we're going to hear is our pastor, the Reverend Dr. Earl C. Johnson. Let's give God, both of them, a hand clap as they come.
Anointing fall on me, sweet anointing, let it fall on me, and let the power of the Holy Ghost, let it fall on me. Sweet anointing, fall on me. Sing, oh Lord. Oh Lord, send your anointing in this place. Oh Lord, in this place, it's the anointing that makes the difference. Pour out your spirit in this presence. Oh Lord, send your anointing in this place. Oh Lord, send us your healing in this place. Oh Lord, send us your power in this place. It's the anointing that makes the difference. Pour out your spirit, Lord,
in this presence.
Oh Lord, send us your power in this place. Send us your healing in this place. Oh Lord,
send us your healing.
Yes, God, in this place. It's the anointing that makes the difference. Pour out your spirit, Lord, in this presence. Oh Lord, send us your healing in this place. Oh Lord, send us your power. We need it in this place, Lord. Oh Lord, send your anointing. Oh, it's the anointing that makes the difference. We need you to pour out your spirit, Lord, right here in this presence. We need you to pour it out. We need you to pour it out, Lord. Oh, won't you send it down? Won't you send it down? In this place, come on and send it down.
Send it down.
Send it down in
this place.
Come on and pour out your spirit, Lord. We need it in this place. Pour out your spirit, Lord. All right, in this place. Come on and send your anointing. In this place.
In this place.
Send your anointing. Keep singing, sopranos. Come back in, altos. Pour out your spirit, Lord. In this place.
In this place.
Pour out your spirit. In this place. Oh, send it down, send it down, send it down, send it down in this place. Oh,
send it down, send it down in this place.
Oh, we need it in this place. Come on, if you want him to send it. Come on, get up on your feet as we receive the man of God. Why don't you just lift your arms up? Open up with expectancy for what it is you need.
Come on, let's praise the Lord in this house one more time. Come on, put your hands together. Do you love him today? Do you love the Lord today? Say yeah. Come on, say it like you mean it. Yeah. Amen. 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 Come on, let's give this praise choir another hand for such marvelous work. Wow, man, you guys are in here today. Woo. Y'all must come to have a good time. Come on, tell your neighbors and neighbor, I come to worship, and I didn't come to watch. Come on, put your hands together one more time in the house of the Lord. Amen, amen. Wow, you may be seated. May be seated. I thank God for you all today. And wow, did y'all really listen to that testimony from that brother? I mean, I was ready to go home and say, dude, the benediction. We could have walked out of here on that. Amen. Come on, somebody. That's a testimony. I mean, and you could just see it from him, just pouring out of him. That anointing that was there, man. I mean, that was a sincere, very sincere. Testimony. You know, we got testimonies and we got testifonies. That was a testimony. And I thank God for that. Amen. Well, this is third Sunday and we're all getting ready for Thanksgiving and meeting family and friends and doing things that Thanksgiving brings to all of us. And I'm so glad to just be within the ranks of you all again today, standing in this sacred pulpit to deliver a message from what may seem to be the eve of Thanksgiving. I'm so grateful and so thankful that I'm here with you for another Thanksgiving season. Amen. Amen. Thank you all for keeping me here for another season. Amen. 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 I appreciate that. I want to give a shout out to some people this morning. First of all, to our crew that was here yesterday handing out boxes of food to individuals who drove by. I want to give them a shout. I know who they are, but I'm not going to name all of them. But I just want to give them a shout out. Come on, can we stand on our feet? We gave away 265 boxes yesterday to help somebody have a Thanksgiving meal on this Thanksgiving. And I think that ought to be worthy of a compliment. Amen? Amen. Amen. That was a marvelous feat. And I thank all of those who participated. And certainly want to thank our leadership team on the day for getting things ready and prepared for us to worship on the day as well. I have one other thing I want to say about what people are doing, and look, I'm not doing this for everybody. This is just a one-time thing. Okay. Sister Maxine, stand up. Stand up, Sister Maxine. You all see her dancing, right? But one thing you might not know, she spent an entire year working on getting a license as a licensed dancer. Amen? Amen? An entire year. Amen. Amen. God bless you. We thank you for that. Amen. And it wasn't for her, it was for you. So you can enjoy the praises that go up and the blessings come down. Amen. Amen. So I thank God for her and for her giving of herself to do that for First Baptist Church, Denby. And I think that is the kind of dedication that we all need. Kind of dedication that we all look for. Amen. And we can all appreciate it at the same time. And so if you have your Bibles with you, I want you to turn back to Jeremiah and Jeremiah chapter 8. And before I get there, I do have a little saying. You know, I mean, this might be kind of corny, all right, but I'm going to lay it out there anyway. All right. Here it comes. All right, so what was Noah in the Bible, what was his favorite food? See, I got you. Ham. He had a son named Ham. Y'all missed that way, y'all. Noah had a son named Ham, right? You got it? Come on, say it with me. Noah had a son named Ham. All right, got it. I know I'm gonna get some comments on that. back to Jeremiah chapter 8. And I'm going to read from verse 19. Behold, the voice of the cry of the daughter of my people, because of them that dwell in a far country. Is not the Lord in Zion? Is not her king in her? Why have they provoked me to anger with their graven images and with strange vanities? The harvest is past, the summer is ended, and we are not saved. For the hurt of my daughter, of my people, I am hurt. I am black. Astonishment has taken hold on me. Is there no balm in Gilead? Is there no physician there? Why, then, is not the health of my people, the health of my daughter, not recovered? Amen. Amen. I want to think on this topic for a few moments, a balm in Gilead. Ernest Gaines, in his book, A Lesson Before Dying, does his best to show his readers that there are people who still have compassion for others and that there's hope in a grand ending to what seems to be human tragedy. Let me say that again. Ernest Gaines, in his book, A Lesson Before Dying, does his best job to the readers to let them know what compassion looks like and that hope is still there on a grand scale for those who think that human tragedy has set in. He tells a story that rings true today about a young black man named Jefferson who is wrongly convicted of murder and sentenced to death. Grant Wiggins is his name, who returned to his hometown to teach after attending a university. Grant struggles with staying in his small hometown or leaving to go somewhere bigger. But while he's home and contemplating leaving, his aunt and his godmother convinces Wiggins, who's supposed to be the scholar and the teacher, to visit Jefferson in his cell before he dies. So Wiggins was determined to teach Jefferson, who's in jail and on death row, to teach him some hardcore lessons about life. He showed a passion for Jefferson and what he was about to face and how to face the reality of his suffering. And in the end, the doom came. Jefferson was executed, but Wiggins was able to help the wounds of a man going to his execution. There was a sort of interconnectedness between them as they saw the world from different perspectives. And I think all of us need a Wiggins in our lives. All of us have been where Jefferson has been. All of us need a lesson before dying. And I mention a story because of its proximity to what is happening in our nation. Currently, we are faced with two trials at the same time, the same week, the same month, on the same media networks. One is full of racial hatred, and the other is crimes against humanity, where some feel that they can just shoot people and claim self-defense and not have to suffer for their consequences. And y'all been mighty quiet on this, but you better be careful, because that law, that jury that allowed Rittenhouse to walk away, may be judging you one day when somebody rubs up on you. The next thing you know, a shootout happens and they claim self-defense. Stay woke, people. And so we're living in a time where hate and bigotry are marching down our streets, where coded signatures are blurred through the airwaves, where the culture of words has given new meaning to the First Amendment, where pollsters have learned how to lie with statistics and surveys. How do you poll 600 people and say that the American people don't believe this or that? People lie with statistics. We live in a world where an all-white jurors in a multicultural society are still handpicked to decide the fate of one's destiny. Our nation is caught up in what W.E.B. Du Bois claims or talks about when he talks about a two-ness of America. It is only from a new perspective of reference and theological, or this has a new point of reference and theological and sociological implications. The two-ness, not only is it interpreted as a black double consciousness, but also as a symbolic representation of who we are as a nation. It's not just how it feels to be black in an American, but how it feels to be an American and left out of the social and economic strata. The reality, my brothers and sisters, is that we have not done what the Lord has asked us to do. We've abandoned his words and we're running from his grace. God has laid upon us a theological mandate to love one another and to love him, to do justice and walk humbly before him. He requires us to do more and become a better nation, to live up to the creeds that all men or all people are created equal, the creeds that govern human life. And when a nation fails to do what God requires, there are consequences. When we fail to take care of the poor and the needy, there are consequences. When we fail to love one another, as the Bible declares, there are consequences. When we fail to speak highly of our neighbors, there are consequences. When we fail to turn the other cheek, there are consequences. When we fail to lift up the name of God, there are consequences. When we hate, there are consequences. When we lie and cheat and deceive and steal, there are consequences. As one person said some time ago, God don't like no ugliness. That's bad English, but it's good theology. It seems that a nation that prides itself as a Christian nation has forgotten the God that they claim to worship. For conservatives, evangelicals, God is not a God of the poor, but a self-help God. A God that requires you to pull yourself up by your bootstrap, even though you don't have any boots. And for liberals, God is a God who is involved in human affairs and cries out about the injustices and the oppression of current establishments. The fact, my brothers and sisters, is that God can't be both. God is either for justice or for injustice. He can't be a God that say, I can't help you, and a God that says, I will be there with you always, even until the end of the age. Something must give. And as we embrace another Thanksgiving week that God has blessed us with, and we are so thankful to be here, I want to suggest this. That Thanksgiving, as much as it's a time for family gatherings and playing games and coming together, Thanksgiving is also a moment of reflection on God's guidance and God's directions for us as a people and as a nation. Our Thanksgiving prayer ought to be for the nation. What we do, we ought to be considerate of others. We ought to ask God to give us a better heart, to help us in our daily walk, to be more kind, to be better and not bitter. We should all seek answers to how God will conform those who may be full of grief. And I know that somebody in your family this week going to be full of grief. Somebody going to have some hardship. Not everybody around your table is going to be all right. There will be some grief, sorrow, and sadness. And so we need a social and a spiritual purging from idolatry and get back to God's agenda. In other words, lay your idols down for a moment and think about the goodness of God. So all we need to do is look around in our country today and ask where God is missing. And I would venture to say Cal Rittenhouse, 17 years old when he committed a crime, 18 years old now, who killed two people and wounded another, was acquitted of all charges by a nearly all-white jury and a biased judge. Look at where our nation is going. Ahmaud Arbery is on trial. The killers of Ahmaud Arbery are on trial. First of all, there should not be a trial at all. The fact that they have a trial is an injustice to injustice, to justice. Why are they on trial anyway? I mean, you think you and I would be on trial if the strip was flipped? Come on, y'all, work with me this morning. No, you won't. So why is there a trial in the first place? It almost makes justice look like a joke. As three white men attempts to escape justice after killing an unarmed black man. And I can't get into all the details with you, but you already know what they are. Kevin McCarthy stood on the House floor and delayed a vote on the Bill Back Better bill, a bill that would drastically reduce poverty in this country, that would make life better for the nation's children, and do something about running through the roof prescription drug costs and raise jobs and employment numbers, and he stands on the floor for 8 hours. A whole day arguing that we don't need it. And so, this is the same man, McCarthy's the same man who refused to censor a fellow Republican, Paul Gosar, you know what I'm talking about, for a depiction of him cutting off the head of Alexandra Ocasio and threatening the president of the United States. He would not condemn that, but he would spend 8 hours saying that we don't have to help elderly people get lower prescription costs. Or we don't have to give child care credits to those who need it. Or we don't need to lift people out of poverty. You get where I'm going. People are mad and angry at school boards and threatening others because they can't have their way. They're mad because somebody took their bottle. Come on, y'all. Somebody take your bottle, you get mad because you on the bottle. Amen. It's what Michael Dyson called white privilege. You know, this ain't supposed to happen to us because we white. We can plead kept self-defense and get away with it because we white. This country is built for us. In other words, our nation is sick and in need of a doctor. Amen, somebody. Come on, let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. We are wounded, and we are a wounded nation. And it became a nation, we have become a nation that has forgotten God. And this is the text that we deal with today. Listen to the scenario that we find in Jeremiah. The people in Judah and in Jerusalem were found guilty of idolatry and apostasy. Of all the great blessing that God had rained down on them through the years, brought no real change to the nation. Y'all hear what I just said? Of all the blessing God had given them, it brought no real change to the nation. They didn't live up to God's instructions. They abandoned God's word. They were like us. They went against God's intended purposes. And it was a wounded nation that had strayed away from Jehovah. And get this, apostasy, my brothers and sisters, is not just backsliding, but apostasy is knowing what God wants and refusing to do it. People became addicted to their own pleasures and desires. Jeremiah's assignment, as well as mine, was to warn the people of the consequences of their actions. His assignment was to issue a warning and demonstrate God's discipline. The nation, the leaders had turned their back because of what you have done, said the Lord, because you have treated people unjustly and have defamed my name. This is what's going to happen to the nation. He says people will cry out for peace, but there will be no peace. People will fall and not rise again. The pen of the scribes will be in vain. They shall be cast down and be consumed. There will be no grapes on the vine, no figs on the tree, no olives on the olive branch. Everything will fade. There will be no fruit cropping up at its usual time. And the things that the Lord has given you will pass away. The harvest is past. The summer has ended, and we are not saved. Israel, you have had your time. You had a whole season to get it right. America, you've had a whole season to get your act together. But now the summer has passed, and you still ain't got it right. God has brought, had brought them out of the light, but they refuse to walk in the light that God brought them out of. And that's a problem with some of us. God has brought us out of light, but we refuse to walk in the light. Brought us out of darkness, but we refuse to walk in the light. They had wounded themselves beyond repair. Idolatry had engulfed the nation, and idolatry, according to the Bible and according to biblical Christianity, is serving, worshiping, giving, thinking, doing, possessing anything that puts it in competition with God. Y'all got some things that's in competition with God, and you need to lay them aside. Anything that you're worshiping is in competition with God. Anything you give more time to than more than God, then it's in competition with God. So you don't let your car be in competition with God. Don't let your house that you live in be in competition with God. Don't let anything be in competition in your life with God. The Bible says, God says, I am a jealous God. So here we witness Jeremiah's pain for the people. And he spells it out. His heart is weak. He is heartbroken. He's wounded. He's crying. He's sad. He's despondent. And as he watches a nation destroy itself, he wept for himself. And he wept for the people. He says, I am black and astonishment has taken hold of me. Now, I don't think Jeremiah is saying here that he's black as a color. Some of y'all really need to get the real definition of black. You know why folks want to call you black? Black in the text, if you take it from a Hebraic standpoint, really means to be saddened, to be in sorrow, to be downcast. So be careful somebody call you black. What do you mean? Is it a race or just sullen? So let's get that together. Amen. And so Jeremiah's pain is there. And in the midst of all that's going on, Jeremiah asks a significant and important question. Say, is there no balm in Gilead? Is there no physician there? We see his pain, his sadness, see him crying as he watches a nation destroy itself. He wept for himself and he wept for the nation. For Jeremiah, it was the people who had a problem with Yahweh. Yahweh didn't have a problem with the people. See, God doesn't have a problem with us. We got a problem with God. It was the people who refused to obey God. It was the people who allowed idolatry to set in. It was the people who should have known better than to test God. It was the people. It was the people who blatantly denied the righteousness of God. It was the people who messed up a good thing with God. The people, he declared, had put themselves on a lonely island of despair. His heart was heavy. Jeremiah was full of gloom. In fact, the Bible says that Jeremiah was so full of hurt that he wished that his head was a fountain. He wished that he could bow and somebody would pour a bucket of water over his head, because that's how many tears that he wanted to share for the nation. It was the people that messed up, but it was Jeremiah, who we call the weeping prophet, who wept for the nation. I've been called sometimes the weeping preacher. I don't mind weeping every now and then either. Amen, somebody. Sometimes you got to cry for those who ain't got sense enough to cry for themselves. Amen. And if you look out in this nation and see what's going on, you'll shed a tear too. So the people had put themselves against God. In verse 20, it tells the truth. Verse 20, check it out. he makes, or Jeremiah makes it plain. He said, the harvest is past, and it's ended, and we are not saved. Seasons have passed, and crops are not yielding, and people are in despair, and we're still not saved. Have you ever felt that way before? Have you ever cried for those who did not have sense enough to cry for themselves? Have you ever been full of hurt and your heart has been heavy and you've been full of passion and it just won't go away and you won't let it go until God moves and God does something? Have you ever felt that way in your life? Have you ever had a heavy heart for somebody other than yourself? Have you ever felt like weeping for somebody else or something else? Have you ever felt that way and you refused to let it go until there was a solution? Well, let me tell you, Jesus did. Jesus felt pain like Jeremiah as he rode into Jerusalem on the back of a donkey. He looked over the city and he wept at the nation and wondered what the nation had become. Nehemiah also had a heavy heart as he went and saw the land that was ruined for his people. The land of Jerusalem was so terrible. Jeremiah saw it. He went back to the king, Cyrus, and said, King, please let me put a team together and go back into Jerusalem and build the walls. And the Bible said the people had a mind to work. They were leaders in pain. Their hearts were crushed. In reality, my brothers and sisters, in reality is that when the sheep scatters, the shepherd bleeds. And I feel for those leaders who just want to give their people a feel-good sermon, but don't want to see a change in them. Give them a feel-good message, but don't remind the people of the impending doom that's coming their way. They can give a shouting message, but no message of discipline or warning. An avalanche of problems may be coming your way. A tornado may be coming your way, but you'll never know it because all some of them want to do is talk about your ship coming in, and you ain't even got a ship. And neglect to tell you about the impending doom or the storm that's coming your life. And it's coming your way. And sometimes you got to be a warning sign for the people that you shepherd. You have to bleed sometimes. And I know this church is looking for somebody to come in, but please find somebody with a bleeding heart. That's what a church needs, is somebody that know how to bleed for the sheep. And if you can't find anybody that's willing to bleed, then you need to leave them alone, because what we need now are some bleeding preachers. Somebody to feel the pulse of the congregation. Somebody to feel the heartbeat of a congregation. Somebody to be able to gaze where the congregation is going. Somebody to be by your bedside when you think the Lord is taking you out of here. Somebody to pray for you. You need a bleeding preacher. When the sheep scatters, you need somebody to bleed for you. Jesus was a bleeding shepherd. He bled for the sheep, and that's what we need, somebody like that. It's good to get a good message, a shouting message, but every now and then you need somebody to remind you that there's a storm coming your way, that there's trouble on the horizon, that somebody and something else is about to take place. I see it coming. I see what's heading your way, and I'm here to warn you that trouble is on the way. You need somebody to warn you. Not just make you shout. Amen, somebody. Find somebody with a bleeding heart. Jeremiah's heart bled for the people. He cried out, Lord, is there no balm? My people are sick. The nation is sick. We are sick. Where is the help? Is there no balm? in Gilead. Jeremiah has come, y'all have a seat. Jeremiah had come to a dead sea. He had come to a dry place in his life, and I'm getting ready to park the car. Had come to a dry place in his life. He's like a wounded animal. He asked the question, is there no balm? Is there no physician? It is not a question, my brothers and sisters, of fact that he's raising. No. It is not a question directed to anybody else. Jeremiah's talking to himself. It's not a question that is addressed to God or to Israel. No, it's not that kind of question. It's a question where Jeremiah is searching for his soul. Jeremiah is doing some soul searching here. I see the problem. I know what's going on. I see the shouting. I see the screaming. I see the injustice. And Jeremiah is screaming out, is there no balm for this? Is there no healing for this? Can this culture keep going on like it's going on? Where is the help? He's crying out. We need physicians. We need a balm. And he's raising it not to anybody else, but he's searching his soul. And I come to tell you, my brothers and sisters, every now and then, we need to do a little soul searching ourselves. Am I right about it? Where we examine who we are and whose we are, and we give thought about our emotions and individual correctedness. But he asked the question about the healing of a nation. Can the nation be healed? Is there a remedy for the maladies of life? How can we overcome the things that have overcome us? When it looks that everything is beyond repair, it looks like the nation can never get it together again. But Jeremiah sees something that a lot of people does not see. He's not asking, is there a balm in Gilead? He's telling you that there is a balm in Gilead. So he turns, the insight here is that it's one of optimism and not pessimism. Jeremiah is not pessimistic about the future, but he is optimistic about the future. He is a kind of Philippian theology. And don't try to look that up, because it ain't nowhere to be found. It's something I just made up. All right. But it's a theology where things are flipped around. What says in, what is it, Deuteronomy 6, that you won't be the tail, but God will make you the head. And so what Jeremiah sees here is not the tail end of something, but he sees the head of something. He's looking into the future, and he sees that God has already flipped this thing into from pessimism to optimism. He says, is there anybody to heal the wounds of the people? The balm that Jeremiah speaks of, and now I'm getting ready to dock the boat. The balm that Jeremiah speaks of comes from a land in Gilead, which grew trees that produced balm. In Israel, in Jeremiah's time, this balm was used as a cure to heal certain maladies. The healing ointment had to be imported. Y'all don't hear me. It had to be imported from a foreign land. Why? Because it had to come from a long distance, because in Palestine, the land was so arid. The land did not have the nutrients that was necessary to produce the balm trees. See, everything don't grow in the same environment. You have to have the right environment. So the balm that Jeremiah speaks of was not in Palestine. It had to be imported from somewhere else. And so these trees would not grow there, but they grew in Gilead. Jeremiah describes his pain, but he also formulates a question. And he gives a question, and the question is there a balm in Gilead? And lastly, he gives an answer. He describes his pain, he formulates a question, and then he gives the answer. So it's not that there is no balm or no cure. What he's really saying is that there is a balm in Gilead, and there are physicians there. Jeremiah gives a forecast. There is a balm in Gilead to heal the nation. The sickness that he talks about is not physiological. It is not psychological. It is not sociological. It is not even theological. But it's a sickness that's so deep that no, not any physician can heal it. No matter how good you are in applying the balm on the wounds of the nation, you don't have what it takes to heal the deep wounds of the nation. We can do a good patch-up job. We can do that. We can put a band-aid on it. But we need a physician that knows how. A physician that knows what he's doing. A physician that can heal the wound. And there's only one person that can do that. So the sickness in the nation, and I'm not talking about a migraine headache. I'm not talking about cancer. I'm not talking about COVID. I'm not talking about any other sickness. I'm talking about a physician that can heal all wounds. Jeremiah looked into his spiritual hourglass, and he saw God at work 600 years later. He looked down in the hourglass and saw God working 600 years down the road. God was working to bring the healing to his people 600 years later. Jeremiah was a prophet, not P-R-O-F-I-T, but a biblical prophet. And he saw God at work even before man saw what God had done. He'd already prophesied here 600 years earlier that he saw. And I come by to ask somebody, can you see God working in your life before God even works? Can you see the wheels turning before God even moves? Can you see it happening, Brother Wright, even before God does it? Can you see God moving in your life even before the problem arises? Can you see? Jeremiah saw this. He was talking about, Jeremiah wasn't talking about a tree. He was talking about the great physician. He was talking about the Alpha and the Omega. And the old folks said, the lily and the valley, and the bright and the morning star. That's what Jeremiah was talking about. And a lot of times, folks, we look at education and say, you know, education, I use that to try to heal my wound. But let me tell you, education is good, but it can't heal your wound. Culture is good, but culture can't heal your wound. It can polish you up, but it can't heal your wound. It can't be the healing arm. Exercise is good. It makes you feel good, but it can't heal you. Eating 3 meals a day is a requirement, but it won't heal you. You need somebody who knows how to heal a nation. And the only person I know is Jesus himself. Somebody wrote some time ago that God specializes. You know what I'm talking about? Anybody know that song? God specializes. Do you have any rivers that seem uncrossable? Do you have any mountains that you can't tunnel through? God specializes. When your body is full of disease, God specializes. When the medicine doesn't work, God specializes. When your body is not at ease, God specializes. When your money runs short and you got more month left than money, God specializes. When it looks like it never get done, God specializes. Am I right about it? God specializes. He can do what no power on earth can do. That's why the angel said his name shall be called Wonderful, and he shall heal his people of their sin and of their wounds. Jeremiah wanted to know, is there a balm in Gilead? And he looked a few thousand years later, or had he looked, as I get ready to land a plane, my time is up. My little timer is going off up here. But Jeremiah wanted to know about the bomb. And he looked 600 years into the future and saw what God was doing. But I want to let somebody here know that if Jeremiah had looked maybe 2,000 years later, if he had gone beyond the 600 years and gone maybe 1,000 or 2,000 years later, he would have recognized that there was a people who was not too far removed from slavery who could have provided him with an answer. Can I get a witness in here? Our ancestors could have answered that for Jeremiah. They could have answered that in 1619 or in 1719 or in 1819 or in 1919 or in 2019. They would have had an answer for him. They were heroes of wood and carriers of water. They could have given Jeremiah the answer for him. Had they asked our ancestors, they would have told him, yes, there is a balm in Gilead. There is a balm to make the wounded whole. There is a balm to heal the sin-sick soul. And I watched my mother. I watched my mother, you all know, I talk about her a lot. She's 99 years old. She's a direct descendant from slavery, two generations removed. She was born in 1922. Her mother was born in 1894. Her grandmother was born in 1844. And sometimes I look at her face and I look at her eyes. I look at the gray hair and I watch her walk and I watch her words. And I say to myself, imagine the pain and the hardship that's written all over her. Look at the untold stories that she has already forgotten. And if I ask her today, Mama, is there a balm in Gilead? I'm sure my mama will agree that there is a balm in Gilead, because he brought me from a mighty long way. He provided for me all the way. He brought me these 99 years and he's keeping me now. Won't you stand on your feet and give God a hand clap of praise? Come on, tell your neighbor, there is a balm in Gilead. There is a balm to make the sin-sick whole. There is a balm in Gilead to heal our sin-sick souls. So on this Thanksgiving Eve, as we sit around the dinner table, let us remind our family members, those who are sick, not well, and even ourselves, that Jesus is the balm. Come on, somebody, tell your neighbor, Jesus is the balm. Somebody say he came down from 42 generations. He died on Calvary's cross, born in a manger, died on the cross, walked out of Joseph's borrowed tomb, and he said, I have all power, all power, all power in my hands. Power to live, power to heal, power to make right, power to turn it around. He got all power in his hand. And I'm so glad that Jeremiah saw the vision. Jeremiah saw God at work. Jeremiah saw 600 years God in the works. He saw Jesus coming. And I'm so glad he came. He came and he died. And I'm glad he died. Somebody ought to shout, I'm glad he died. He died on Calvary for me. He died all night. He died till the earth got drunk. He died till the curtains in the temple was torn asunder. He died. He died. But the Bible says he didn't just die, but he got up. He got up. He got up. He got up with all power in his hand. And he got up for me. He got up for you. He got up for all of us. Now I've landed my plane, parked my car, docked my boat. Now it's up to you this Thanksgiving to do the same thing. Amen. Don't leave the dinner table. Don't leave the Thanksgiving table until you have done one. Land a plane or park a car or dock a boat. Amen, somebody. Come on, let's give the Lord another hand clap of praise. Our sister, God bless you. Hallelujah. We're going to open the doors of the church. Maybe somebody here today don't know the Lord, and you might be saying to yourself, I don't want to go home and have the stuff all on me. I want to know I have a Savior who loves me and cares for me. You might be saying, I need a Savior to make a way for me as I travel on the roads and the byways, going to whatever destination you may be going to. I need a Savior to protect me while I'm gone. If that's you, won't you come on down the aisle? If you want to come by baptism, if you want to come by Christian experience, whatever way you want to come, this is your time now. I promise I'll walk with you if you come now. If you would just step out of the aisle, I'll come with you. I'll come with you if you come. This is your time. This is your moment. This is your opportunity if you're here. Hallelujah. Well, praise the Lord. God bless you. God bless you. Minister Grace is bringing his mother here. Down the aisle. Hallelujah. 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 Well, I did say I'd meet you halfway, didn't I? Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Is there another? Is there another? Come on out of your seats if you're here. Come on. We want you, but God wants you more. We want you, but God wants you more. You might get a pen and everything you need to get the information. Hallelujah. She's coming on Christian experience today. Amen. Yes, joining the church on Christian experience. Amen, amen. Come on, y'all can do better than that. Let's get the devil mad up in here. Let's get the devil mad. Let's get him mad. Amen. Amen, amen. She's a transplant from Ohio. And she has been brought here for a son to take care of her. And she wants a church home. Glory God. And she's Glory. Chosen this place to be a church home. Amen. We're going to close out with a Thanksgiving prayer. Y'all keep your mask on and you can come up. Whatever you want to do, stay where you are. Whatever you want to do today. We're going to close up with a Thanksgiving prayer. That God would bless us on this Thanksgiving Eve. That God would protect you as you're on the highway. Got another message coming.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. Church family, I just want to do one more thank you. I forgot to mention this earlier. Want to thank the church family, those here, those that are home. Our relief donations that we contributed to Haiti as well as to New Orleans. The total was $3,716.
Amen.
So we just want to thank the church family for that.
Amen.
$3,716.
Praise God. Praise God. Come on, that's worth a shout out. Thank you all. Thank you all. That's the money you all gave. Praise God for it. Let's go into a word of prayer. Father God, we thank you again for what we heard and what we see. We thank you for the melodies that warmed our hearts. We thank you, Lord, for this worshipful moment. We thank you for inspiring our hearts and motivating us to do good and be just and to do right with our fellow man and woman. We thank you, Lord, for the gathering of the saints here at First Baptist Church. We praise your name on this glorious day that you've given us, a day that was ushered in and a day that we'll never see again. But we thank you for it. We thank you for the beauty of your holiness. We thank you for the privilege to be able to stand before your altar. We thank you for the honor to be able to call Jesus our Father, to call him our Lord and our Savior. We thank you for the grace and the mercy that you showered upon us. We thank you for the multitude of blessings that's come our way. And we thank you, Lord, for all the benefits of following your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for leading us. We thank you for your leadership, for your guidance. We thank you, Lord, for the heavenlies that open up and give us life and light that we need in order to survive. Thank you for the air that we breathe, for the cars that we drive, for the shelter that's over our head, for the food that we eat, for gas in our cars, for tires on our cars. We thank you, Lord, for everything that you do for humanity today. We give you honor, we give you praise and glory. We thank you for healing our bodies when everybody else had given up, Lord. We thank you, even doctors have given up, but we thank you, Lord, that you've healed us. And thank you for healing the nation, oh God. And for being the balm that we need, not only in a nation, but need in our lives. Thank you for those who are standing in the sanctuary today. We pray for every family, for every individual. We pray for their children, their children's children, their grandmother. We pray for those, oh God, who are on the highways this week. Wherever they may be going, God, we ask you to bless them in a special way. Be with them. Be their protector. Don't be the co-pilot, but be the pilot. Be with them, Lord. Bless them. Let us cherish this day. Cherish this week. God, we thank you so much for Minister Gracious bringing his mother down to be part of this congregation. We thank you so much for her, for choosing this branch of Zion to be a place of worship, a place of teaching, a place of good leadership, a place where she can dwell and depend on a good word and a good message from the Lord, and a good place to grow and develop. We thank you for that, God. And we thank you, Lord, for all of our leadership. Continue to be with my brother, Deacon Archie. Continue to bless him and touch his body, Lord, and be the balm that he needs on this day. Be the ointment. God, we love you today. We give you all the praise, give you all the honor. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Let the people of God say amen. 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 Come on, say it like you mean it. Amen. 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 You have your seat, we'll give the benediction. Week we'll start the beginning of Advent, and we invite you all to come back. We thank you for your stewardship, for being so faithful in doing what we've asked you to do, and that's to go above and beyond in giving us a portion greater than what God has given you, so we can have money like that, $3,000 extra, so we can give to people who need the help. So we ask you to help us with stewardship, given above and beyond this month. It's not that we're just asking. There's a purpose in the action. And so we just thank you so much. Those on social media who continue to give and give with your whole heart, we thank you, we bless you, and we appreciate you. And if you're in the Newport News area, in what they call Tidewater here, if you're in the area, stop by and pay us a visit.
Don't just watch us on television all the time. Get off the couch and come down and fellowship with us. Amen. We appreciate it. We're a loving church, and we'll love to have you here. Amen. And while I'm doing this, do we have any visitors? If you're a visitor, raise your hand before we leave. You visiting with us today? Okay, we got one. Raise your hand up high so they can see it. Amen, amen, amen. Got one in the back. Thank you, my brother. Well, thank you all, and I'm going to ask Minister Perkins to come back and give us a benediction as we leave this place. I see you all. I'll be on the road. I'll be at Mom's house and everybody's house down in the country. Dan Riley.
I like it like that.
Not Mayberry. Actually, there is no Mayberry in North Carolina. Amen. Thank you all. Y'all have a wonderful Thanksgiving, and we'll see you all next week. Amen. Amen. Come on, let's get the Lord one more hand clap of praise.
Good morning, First Baptist Church, Denby. The word of God has been preached. What a wonderful word. Maybe now look to the Lord to be dismissed. Father, in the name of Jesus, we want to say thank you. We thank you that indeed there is a balm in Gilead. There is a balm in the United States. There is a balm in the world, and his name is Jesus the Christ. We thank you, Father God, for what our eyes have seen. We thank you for what our hearts have felt. We thank you, Father God, for what our ears have heard. We're praying, Father God, that you would continue to allow this word, Father God, to go inside of us and work it out, Father God, on the outside of us. Now till we meet again, we pray, Father God, that you would continue to keep us. We love you, Father God, because you first loved us. We ask all these things. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.